Blackstone Audio presents Tom Sawyer Abroad by Mark Twain. Chapter 1. Tom Seeks New Adventures. Do you reckon Tom Sawyer was satisfied after all them adventures? I mean the adventures we had down the river and the time we set the darky Jim free and Tom got shot in the leg? No, he wasn't. It only just pisoned him for more. That was all the effect it had. You see, when we three came back up the river in glory, as you may say, from that long travel, and the village received us with a torchlight procession and speeches, and everybody hurrahed and shouted, it made us heroes, and that was what Tom Sawyer had always been hankering to be. For a while he was satisfied. Everybody made much of him, and he tilted up his nose and stepped around the town as though he owned it. Some called him Tom Sawyer the Traveler, and that just swelled him up fit to bust. You see, he laid over me and Jim considerable, because we only went down the river on a raft and came back by the steamboat. But Tom went by the steamboat both ways. The boys envied me and Jim a good deal, but land, they just knuckled to the dirt before Tom. Well, I don't know. Maybe he might have been satisfied if it hadn't been for old Nat Parsons, which was postmaster, and powerful, long, and slim, and kind of good-hearted and silly, and bald-headed, on account of his age, and about the talkiest old critter I ever see. For as much as 30 years he'd been the only man in the village that had a reputation. I mean a reputation for being a traveler, and of course he was mortal proud of it, and it was reckoned that in the course of that 30 years he had told about that journey over 1,000,000 times and enjoyed it every time. And now comes along a boy not quite 15 and sets everybody admiring and gawking over his travels. And it just gave the poor old man the high strikes. It made him sick to listen to Tom and to hear people say, my land, did you ever, my goodness sakes alive, and all such things. But he couldn't pull away from it any more than a fly that's got its hind leg fast in the molasses. And always when Tom come to a rest, the poor old critter would chip in on his same old travels and work them for all they were worth. But they were pretty faded and didn't go for much, and it was pitiful to see. And then Tom would take another innings, and then the old man again, and so on for an hour or more, each trying to beat out the other. You see, Parsons' travels happened like this. When he first got to be postmaster and was green in the business, there come a letter for somebody he didn't know, and there wasn't any such person in the village. Well, he didn't know what to do nor how to act, and there the letter stayed and stayed, week in and week out, till the bare sight of it gave him a conniption. The postage wasn't paid on it, and that was another thing to worry about. There wasn't any way to collect that 10 cents, and he reckoned the government would hold him responsible for it and maybe turn him out besides when they found he hadn't collected it. Well, at last he couldn't stand it any longer. He couldn't sleep nights. He couldn't eat. He was thinned down to a shadder, yet he dasn't ask anybody's advice, for the very person he asked for advice might go back on him and let the government know about the letter. He had the letter buried under the floor, but that did no good. If he happened to see a person standing over the place, it had given him the cold shivers and loaded him up with suspicions. And he would sit up that night till the town was still in dark, and then he would sneak there and get it out and bury it in another place. Of course, people got to avoiding him and shaking their heads and whispering, because the way he was looking and acting, they judged he had killed somebody or done something terrible, they didn't know what. And if he had been a stranger, they would have lynched him. Well, as I was saying, it got so he couldn't stand it any longer. So he made up his mind to pull out for Washington and just go to the President of the United States and make a clean breast of the whole thing, not keeping back an atom, and then fetch the letter out and lay it before the whole government and say, now there she is, do with me what you're a mind to. Though as heaven is my judge, I am an innocent man, and not deserving of the full penalties of the law, and leaving behind me a family that must starve, and yet hadn't had a thing to do with it, which is the whole truth, and I can swear to it. So he did it. He had a little wee bit of steamboatin' and some stagecoachin', but all the rest of the way was horseback, and it took him 3 weeks to get to Washington. He saw lots of land and lots of villages and 4 cities. He was gone most 8 weeks, and there never was such a proud man in the village as he when he got back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.